is there a view as agents coming to this industry, to this party, which is essentially extremely well established, extremely, no doubt, successful, let's be honest, as an industry. Why do we, you know, do we consider ourselves as part of that industry now, or are we something else?
Our way of thinking is very different to the insurance industry, which fundamentally really focuses on product rather than customer. So we've actually created everything around the customer. So, but at the same time, we are providing that peace of mind that is no longer being provided. So there is, we are doing insurance. And in a way, having previously launched a cycle syndicate, which is a peer-to-peer alternative to bike insurance, it's actually quite helpful to be part of insurance because that's something that consumers recognize. So there's a kind of a whole, I suppose, a kind of dichotomy that goes on between the fact that we are providing what we are providing, insurance, and yet the way we behave, the way we approach things, and the way we treat customers is more tech and the kind of trust that you might have more in Apple than you would do in AIG.
Okay.
I don't think we behave like a traditional insurance company. I think insurance is based on trust and relationships, and ultimately, it takes a while to build that trust and relationships, whether it be with an individual customer or whether it be with a capacity provider. That's better. And I think it's very difficult to build those relationships from scratch rapidly. So certainly if we look at the makeup of our team, we've got people who've worked in the insurance sector for 15, 20 years on either our advisory panel or assisting us on a day-to-day basis. But I wouldn't say that we behave in any way, shape or form like an insurance company. I've worked for three now, and I can honestly say, yeah, the experience we're having at the moment and the way that the behaviours we're exhibiting as a team are nothing like you see in a traditional insurance environment. You've got to behave much more like a tech startup. There's a lot of hype around the sector, and yes, it's moving rapidly, considering how slowly insurance does move. But will there be a Google moment? Yes, that will come, but that will be a while away. There's not going to be something that flies very, very quickly. So I say trust and relationships are key. You don't build them overnight. It takes a while to get that.
Just checking. Cool. Awesome. I guess I'll just to answer the actual question, the answer is yes, we are part of the insurance industry. Of course we are, because we have to be, right? But then obviously, two gentlemen to my right, they picked up on the undertone, which is, are we like the insurance industry? Do we behave in the same way? And I feel like if you look at any industry that's been disrupted by technology, the startups and the innovators and disruptors in these industries never behave like the progenitors before me. You know, they bring their own thinking, they bring their own processes, they bring their own ways of doing things. However, I would say in this industry in particular, because I've worked across ranges of industries, you have to have the old guard. You cannot just set them aside. I would say 50% of one is people with significant experience in the insurance industry. You know, we have a guy, he used to be a CEO of a big insurance company. Our CFO used to be head of finance for a big insurance company. Our actuary, our legal counsel. Like, I can't do that. I can't go to the reinsurance deal. I can't go to our regulator and get an insurance license. It's stupid to think that. Well, myself and then the other 50% of the team we bring the customer's perspective. We bring the knowledge of our technology and how that can be leveraged in order to provide better service level for customers. So we are in the insurance industry and we can't turn it on its head. We have to work within it. Whether or not you need to be an MGA and work with an insurer to build it, or whether you need to be disrupting a particular part of insurance, or whether you need to build your own one from scratch, or this is truly disrupted, is a different question. But we're definitely in it. As far as trust is concerned, the research I've shown insurance, sorry, actually dictates that the best service level providers, your Googles, your Apples, your Amazons, are less trusted with your personal data than the banks, the government, the health industries, and the insurers. The reason being, the second you stop trusting those guys, it's Planet of the Apes, it's Mad Max, because ultimately they're so intrinsic to society. So I would say that we're in a wonderful position in InsurTech, because I believe in the next 5 to 10 years, there will be the Google moment or the Facebook moment, and that player, which will be providing insurance, will be the most valuable company, well, because they'll have access to the most data.
Let's come on to that in a second.
Well, we're out of the, started in the legal tech industry, if you know. Legal technology is really legal technology. It's a good 15 years behind insurance tech. It's really, truly important. And when we got started, I said, okay, well, who are my best clients going to be? So I wrote a little script to find out who gets sued the most. It's the insurers, and insurers as well. So decided insurance is really where we have to make the effort to go and find customers, and the 70-odd people that work for Premonition, none of them have an insurance background. So we're here to make friends and look for partners that do.
Okay, great. Okay, thanks, Les. Why has the, if you're so convinced that, sorry, totally aside, I guess, probably an anomaly, but certainly for the other three, to varying degrees, what I'm getting a sense is that there's some sort of, like, you know, there's a sense of this moment happening in the future, sometime, or happening now, which involves, you know, the whole industry being Kodak. Which is arguable. But why do you think the industry is in the shape that it is at the moment? Why do you think that you know, these extremely smart people have not, you know, extremely well funded, extremely well capitalized, with extremely deep understanding of a very, very long-standing industry doesn't really have this idea, hasn't had. But you, why is it you think you've had this idea that they haven't had? I don't know. But where should we start? Let's start with Sam.
I think that's a good question. I'd say that traditional insurance companies create product segment markets and then work out how to market to that segment. And I think what we're all doing is something that's focused and driven around by consumer, purely for the consumer's benefit. And ultimately, we feel passionately, I would say, that that is where the markets go. But the market's evolving rapidly. There's a lot of hype. There's a lot of investment. There'll be a lot of investment errors and mistakes. I think from an evolutionary perspective, that Google moment will come, but it's not going to come in the next 12 or 24 months. It's going to take a little while.
Right, but sorry, but to rephrase the question, why does the panel think that it has an insight into the market that is not present in the audience?
Sure. I mean, at least from my perspective.
Sorry, to be direct.
No, it's a really good question. From my perspective, my lack of an insurance background is really important, because I look at it strictly from the perspective of a customer. Mm. And then, you know, hopefully I've got a reasonably smart enough mind that once I start looking into the industry and working out what it's trying to achieve, and then really delving into why I can't do that, that's when you get your answers to the question. So, I mean, it always comes down to legacy, ultimately.
So are you saying you haven't done that exercise?
No, I have. Okay. So ultimately, it comes down to a 10 million CEOs and businesses research. But ultimately, what it comes down to is the fact that they have legacy problems. They have legacy cultural issues, which cannot be understated. Like the way you move up, look at the CEOs of every major insurance company this year. They have to work their way up a shit slide that is like their life to the top. And ultimately, once you reach the top and you're 45, 50 years old, or whatever the age may be, the desire to suddenly revolutionize the whole company isn't there anymore. I think that's quite natural. And then the technology that they're dealing with is genuinely from the 70s. It's spaghetti in its nature. So I don't believe that
there's no great reason why insurance companies can't spend a very significant amount of money transforming their culture, transforming their technology stack, and then where are you?
I mean, you actually asked those guys how to do it. Ultimately, they would say it's not economically viable to simply transfer every single one of their customers to a new tech. Yeah, so because it literally costs a lot of money. I mean, which is why it's just like, imagine a big ferry, a gigantic ferry, turning left. that's the insurance industry, and we happen to have built speedboats. And but then they have all the customers, all the money, and so you've got this wonderful. How do we overtake them? Or can we overtake them? Is the question.
So Farid, I think the reality is this industry has had very crusty margins for a long period of time. And because the barriers to entry are high, regulation is strong, there's a requirement for capital, it's an old boys club, so you don't have, you can't bypass segments of the value chain if you decide to kind of try and take out margins in that value chain. Which is why you have an industry which has got the most extraordinary value chain where everyone's making 10-20% net margin over a long period of time. And as a result, why would you actually change? Your mate, who's the broker or the underwriter, is having a cushy time. You spend a lot of time on your golf course. It's great. Why would you go and try and break that? So there's fundamental good reasons why they have done that. So there was no kind of threats. And then at the same time, there's a now that they've actually only woken up. But I mean, they've woken up. It's quite recent they've only woken up. I mean, if you think about Connect, which was basically kind of $75 million, which was pulled down the drain for Lloyd's London, trying to innovate, kind of introduce technology and kind of IT in the early 2000s, that's just that shut down. And it's only in the last 5 years, and actually last 2 years, where actually InsurTech came out as a coined phrase, that suddenly the CEOs kind of looked at, kind of thought, oh, we need to do something.
Right. So, but I think every industry can point to specific examples of failures or attempts to change industries, and those have been, in some cases they have been unsuccessful. Some cases they have been quite successful. Give me some insight into the minds of the startups here that are looking at, transforming an industry in some significant way by more customer centricity, maybe better underwriting, maybe better, different kind of customer segmentation. For me, that there's one question here, which is, what are you guys doing differently, fundamentally? And if it's more customer centric focus, then how defensible is that in real terms, when you probably don't have any customers yet, you're just starting out on the road, and that's okay because everyone has to start somewhere. But it sounds like we're going to, we've got this nice story where we're going to build very large businesses based on this aspiration that, by being marginally more customer centric, the customers will suddenly flock to you, and with the greatest of respect, that may or may not be true. And if it was true, it might be, it's arguable that the existing industry might have done that already. So tell me what you're doing differently. In one sentence,
I think what we're all doing is actually looking at the value chain and rethinking it. So the reality is, as you were mentioning earlier, the incumbents can't go in and say, change the Titanic, move it in 90 degrees.
Well, they potentially can.
Well, culturally it's really hard, and you speak to anyone in industry,
yeah,
they'll go, we'd love to, we can't.
So culturally, hit me with the real secret. I mean, you don't have to give away your secret, so if you don't want to, that's fine. But is it around customer-centric activity? Is it something specific that you understand about customers? Like, where's this? Where's the substance, right?
I think the very, very basics.
Yeah.
Service levels. It's a service-driven industry, right? So Signing up to insurance should be really easy. Understanding your insurance should be incredibly transparent. You shouldn't be under or over-insured for what you need. And then ultimately a direction where we believe a single policy that protects your whole entire life using technology for connected devices and connected lives, which makes insurance nothing sexy, nothing that you would
like. Okay, great. So we've got service levels. Dan.
I think we're very much service level driven, but I would say that we're partner driven. So we're partnering with those major corporates. We're partnering with technology providers in that technology stack. So we're not saying we're going to rebuild everything from scratch and be that full stack provider. So we partner with Right Indem from a claims management perspective. Some of you may have heard of them. We partner with the likes of Instander or ID Applications on a, uh, from from a policy administration software perspective. So our view is take best of breed technology, build great relationships with leading brands that enable us to get large amounts of traction very quickly.
Okay.
I mean, I think with internet companies in general, most of them are doing just very incremental or boring kind of things. They're taking tasks which already exist in the offline world and digitizing them. But when you really get innovation is when you ask a completely different question and you approach things with a completely different model. That's when it really starts to change. Because when you go incremental, there's a minor advantage to working with the newcomer, and it's easy for an existing incumbent to do something a little bit better and get there. When you ask a different question, you're completely redefining the market, and the incumbents are left out of the cold.
And I think a really good point was made earlier when he said there's the regulation and the high need for capital. So we actually haven't had that many startups actually do it over the past sort of 2 or 3 years. And so you're really only seeing a full, because it was all we had was all this. We have a lot of online brokers, we have a lot of policy management tools, and they were just fix a little piece of it. They weren't tackling the service levels that the real issues need to have with insurance. And now we're starting to see over the last 2 years. So it may take another 5 years, 6 years, 7 years to really see whether it's Lemonade or whether it's Alain in France or whether it's something you look at Jean-Anne in China, the same biggest insurer in China, fully digital. Like, it's happening. It's just, it's a lot of startups are too scared to handle the regulations and the capital requirements.
And every great change in every industry starts with transparency, with people actually understanding what's going on and being able to measure that change.
We've got some questions from the audience, please.
Sorry, my question's for Samir. So you are grappling, is that your name correctly?
Yes.
Okay, good. So you just set up this new insurance business, right? And you've kind of, you're at the beginning of the journey, you haven't got customers yet. I think I looked online, you haven't launched. I have two questions, if you don't mind. First one is, you talked about rewarding people. I'd love to know what you meant by that.
Sure. So when we say giving back, it's ultimately rewarding and motivating behavior. So for example, a lot of people, when they look at insurance companies, one of the issues was trust. It's the idea that you pour money into a black hole and you don't make any claims, and where's it all going? And you have one little car accident, you have one little claim, and your premiums go up, etc. So we just wanted to have a very, very transparent view on how we make our money as an insurance company, so a set fee for what we do, and then there's money to give back if you don't make
claims. Like Lemonade.
Similar, except they did the whole sort of P2P thing, which is all they do.
So when you say reward, you mean give them money back off their cost of their premiums?
No, actual cashback. Well, they'll have the option actually.
So cashback,
cashback or a premium reduction, or also an opportunity to give to charity.
Okay. My second question was, how much money did you raise?
So seed, around $10 million.
Are you done? You raised that? No.
Yeah. So it was last year, and we launched in September this year.
Thank you. Question here.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Joe. My question is on InsurTech and green finance. So green finance is really about financing, making new technology types bankable, so their infrastructure. So for example, wind farms are now bankable, but they weren't always. But onshore wind farms apply BI, business interruption, in order to attract project finance. So for emerging technologies, such as offshore wind, floating offshore wind, underwater wind farms, tidal farms, these technology types are not yet insurable in terms of business interruption to provide a contracted floor that the lenders will expect to see. So my question to you is, how do you see InsurTech having the opportunity to accelerate that process of making a new technology type that's gone through R&D, that's not yet bankable, making it insurable? So you've got business interruption, BI, in a broader sense, through perhaps real-life data from an operating asset, so it gets refinanced and reinsured quicker and on better terms. Is that a challenge for the InsurTech industry?
So the way I see InsurTech, there are three types of innovations. One is the kind of the new models, which is what Samir and I are kind of working on. Then there's kind of new products, and that's what I think what you're trying to bring together too. And then there's incremental innovation, which is basically performance improvement, whether it's kind of a issue. That falls into new products. And what you find is actually so far there are very few. The reality with insurance, you need less capital to underwrite this risk. And the big issue you have is that the owners of that capital are few and far between who actually are prepared to put money behind new products. The only, actually, what's funny enough is actually the reinsurers will be entering that space. None of the primary carriers have actually gone into it, which is shocking, because fundamentally that's what they're meant to be doing, taking risk. And if you, but actually, although if it's that risky, if that kind of esoteric, you might actually find within noise some a bit more avant-garde guys in there who might like it. But the thing is, they're going to price it really high, yeah, I expect.
I really agree with that point. I feel like in what you described, the reinsurers are actually much more likely to want to innovate there than the insurers, for sure. And I think that's a really good point. But I feel like that in itself would be an insurer tag, would be a startup, would be focusing on something along those lines, as opposed to one of us adding that, because we haven't even proven, well, I haven't anyway, proven what I can do in the commercial side for the public.
I think one of the hardest things in insurance is getting relevant capacity from depending upon what product you're looking at. And I know Guy late last year at the Microsoft Accelerator, and he was specifically bringing out an app focused on Lloyd's of London that would provide individuals with connections to capacity providers across a variety of different products. So particularly products that you're mentioning, I think connecting with him, and I can give you his details, would be beneficial.
In short call.
That's it.
Thank you.
Great. One here, and then I come to you.
So all of you have been largely talking about big scale insurance companies. How do you say your services compared to boutique insurers with sort of 20 or so less employees, a small client base where service is everything, the clients are everything, how would you say you compete with them?
They're probably not serving, I mean, we're serving consumers, so the other, it is, are those serving mass market? Because they're more likely to be either kind of looking at high net worth or commercial lines.
Yeah.
I think in commercial there's a dynamic, that different dynamic. And I don't think where it's not. I think there are lots of innovation to be done there, but the core loss of trust is actually more in the consumer lines than it is in the commercial lines, which is why I've gone for the consumer lines to be addressed first.
Yeah, I agree. And in some countries, for example, people really, really rely on their broker to add the value, like with respect to the trust and the insight. I feel like the brokers will be around at least for another 10 years or so, like in my just my personal opinion. However, the more insurance becomes more transparent and easier to use, more technology driven, more plug and play, more automated, more data driven. I feel like people understand their insurance and their coverage much better. It's just that bit easier, which makes it then easier to protect
themselves. Okay, right. But I mean, in reality, right, so I mean, this is a very important question in the sense that it triggers this other element of the transaction that you're talking about, which is trust. And trust from, you know, today is now, trust is the new capital, right? There's, you know, we talked about data in the noughties and you know, whatever it was previous to that, but today the capital of the economy is, you know, is trust. That's what makes the business, every business, work. So I totally get it with your proposition, because clearly, you know, you have data sets to back up the fact that, you know, there's a problem and there's a clear solution and you have data on it, and it's all about the trust. What you're trying to do is actually, in fact, probably unpick a little bit of the trust between the barrister, the local barrister, and the,
exactly,
and the judge themselves. In this case, in the case of the MJ and you know, full stack, what is it that you can do to build more trust?
So I don't think, by the way, that the broker is dead in any shape or form. If you look at A-Plan, it's remarkable. It went for 15 times EBITDA. It's a utility business. And the reason behind that is the average age of their customers has not changed over 10 years. So thinking that the digital is killing brokers and the human thing, I disagree. I actually, in a way, and it's controversial considering that I come thinking about technology and so on, but I suspect in 10 years' time, we'll find actually the real luxury is not having AI, it's actually speaking to a real person. And we're going to have full circle. in the same way as we kind of had all these outsource centers in the past.
Okay, anyway, let's set down.
I think there's a lot to be said for personal relationships, and yeah, certainly in the conversations I've had with brokers, you know, they have clients who have multiple properties, multiple yachts. They like to move their art collection between yachts, and you know, their premium spend might be £50,000 a month. You know, you're always going to need somebody who owns that relationship, who they can meet face to face with, go for lunch, go nightclubbing, and whatever else they do. So, you know, I think we're going after the mass market. I am not looking to own the customer. I'm not looking to own that relationship other than provide a white label platform that facilitates that for leading brands who already have that trusted relationship with multi-millions of customers. So my stats are, you know, we have a client that have 20 million customers. We're looking at a 2-2.5% conversion rate. We can raise that to 3.5%, the clients will accept it. They commit to spend a certain amount on marketing to those customers, which they already do through a multi-channel process already with other products. And my clients break down into two areas: those who are either an existing financial services brand, who are sick to death of working with multiple composite insurers providing different products, all of which have overlay and overlap in terms of the servicing. Or there are those that have never had a financial services brand and are looking to launch one and are captivated by doing something that is driven by the customer.
So essentially where your positioning is, like, because your white label proposition, you leverage the trust relationship of the existing brand.
Exactly.
Let's say that Dan's proposition has, you know, Dan's technology stack is great, or his UX is wonderful, and he's got this great brand, great trusted brand, because these brands are trusted. There's dissatisfaction, but ultimately, insurance, the existing incumbent insurance industry is taking the money right now, and you cannot say to me that indicates a significant lack of trust. There is.
But when insurance is described as a necessary evil, and you ask them, are you prepared to go in with a kind of a new startup which doesn't do it? Which is one of the surveys that Post Magazine did last year for the insurance world. And actually you realise people are quite happy to switch out and try something new, because fundamentally...
In which markets?
In insurance.
Which markets?
Consumer lines.
Okay. Well, I think there's a significant difference. I mean, there is a lot of nuance and behavioural differentials between different products, and certainly for certain most lines, it seems to me that there's a very significant inertia that's being underestimated. And I don't know whether the audience agrees with this or not, but you know, certainly to me, to my expectation, there are only a very small number of lines where there is a very high switching rate, there is a very high turnover rate, you know, the transaction cost is relatively aggregated over a short number, short period of time, for example. So I think it's dangerous potentially to read too much into the lack of trust that insurance companies have, or the lack of the relationship that they have, the lack of depth of that relationship that they've built up over a significant amount of time. You know, Samir, you're screaming in your face.
I disagree with you just as much. I suppose what I agree with is, of course they're trusted. It's what I said earlier. It's like our fundamental part of society. We have to trust them. I think the service level of trust is so poor. Service level of trust. Like our trust in their ability to serve us well.
Right.
And so as such, it's like... To answer the original question, which is where do we as insurtechs try to win trust, the answer, if I give you a reasonable one, is clients. Yeah? It's clients. Yeah. If you handle claims well, people trust you. Like in my perfect world, if we were doing like house liability things like this, I would send a street urchin to every house we sold the thing, and I'd ask them for a proof for every window. And then we would pay those claims within minutes, and those people would be loyal customers forever. In Germany, Switzerland, etc., people have on average 7 insurance policies adult, yet they only have 1.5 policies per insurer. There isn't a particular loyalty and love and trust that potentially was coming across to you when you said. It's a broker trust and a need for insurance, but a trust and service level that doesn't exist.
Okay.
Well, I think over that. Certainly, in the conversations that we've had with composites and the like, a lot of them are achieving over 80% renewal rates. Where they fall down is the moment you go into a claims process, because you're relying on talking to somebody in the call center. Once you've got through to someone, you've been cut off, and then you run back, and then you're talking to somebody else, and then you've got to get on the hold because they're on a different call.
I think that can happen. I think that's,
it does happen.
Yes.
I think it does happen,
but
switching rates around a motor policy at the point of the claim is ridiculous. It's 60-70% people switch at the point at which they've made a claim. Now, there's obvious other reasons relevant to that, but you know, it's not purely restricted to motor. And I think what you can do, certainly with the single policy concept, is that construct enables everybody to have everything centralised in one place. It takes out that pain point. I totally get you.
I just think that, you know, there is an inherent danger of building a startup and announcing to the industry that building your business on the premise of the lack of perceived competency in your existing incumbent industries or your competitor is not necessarily a hugely defensible position. So what do you...
How many of the competitors do you know are vertically integrated from distribution to claim?
Well, there are many. I mean, I think there are a very significant number of examples.
If you look at the main ones,
depending on the industry.
And an FU. Others all have broken up distribution channels, basically kind of value chains.
And you're just talking about distribution now, so...
No, not distribution, value segments. So they'll outsource the kind of claim handling, they'll outsource the distribution, but that means that you can't actually optimize for your customer experience because you are optimizing for each segment and none of them are actually going to communicate with each other and no one's going to be investing in what is required to provide an amazing experience from start to finish.
If I can butt in there, let me explain why it is that I started this business and that will give quite a bit of clarity. So I had no intention to ever start an insurtech business. But I had to, for my father, purchase home insurance on a second property. And he was insured, I won't say who the provider was, but his first property was insured with one household brand that one goes to for clothes and food on a regular basis. And they basically said, sorry, we don't do second homes, but we know a man who can. Call this number. And they sent me to another household brand on the high street that... is never knowing the other soul. And I got speaking to them and they said, yes, we'd love to service you, but I'm sorry, we can't just do your second home, you're going to have to move your first home here as well. So I called back the previous brand and I said, sorry, I'm now moving everything lock, stock and barrel to this new provider. Policy documentation comes. Two sets of policy documents for two homes, okay? Start reading the information and lo and behold, it's two separate insurance companies who are underwriting the product on behalf of this leading brand. So there's a typo in the name on one set of policy documents and there's a typo in the address on the other set of policy documents. So I look for the customer service number or I look to go online, so I amend this. Oh no, you can't do this online, so you call up the call centre and you do it in one instance and it doesn't convey to the other policy because they're two separate companies and they don't have a single view of the customer. In the end, I went and spoke to this leading brand and said, you do realise that this is why I exist and it's your bloody fault. And they said, yeah, and we think it's great that you do exist, but you know, we've got this great big contract with this big composite insurer that's there till 2020. And we can't work with you till then. And I said, okay, that's great, we'll see you in 2020.
Okay.
I've heard this story so many times and I'm 30 years old myself and I feel like I'm just approaching the point in my life where things seem like I recognise I might die at some point and you know, when you buy your first place and you realise that you need to insure stuff, things like this. And so I grew up, I had the internet in my bedroom, which was awful fun, but like just to give you the idea of the service level that I come to expect. And so now when I speak to certain insurers and I go through their processes, both for work as a bit of research, but also for myself, I just couldn't believe it. Like, a friend of mine received a check recently because he made a claim.
Check.
And he genuinely asked me what he needed to do with it. I said, I'm going to give it to them, the money's in your account.
Yeah.
So, that was just my add on to that. The expectation levels of millennials, no matter how you call us, is even higher than this gentleman's.
Let's have a question for the audience. Come on here.
Yeah, we've heard a lot about personal lines insurance. I work for a private equity fund, and we spent the last 3 years researching the insurance market, and we've categorically steer clear of the personal lines market because it's a race to the bottom. The aggregators are
It's
a tough gig, and aggregator is old news now. And whenever we spoke to independent experts in the market, they said, yeah, people might, you know, £10-£20, you know, people might stay for service, but if somebody offers, you know, a £50 discount, people are fickle, people
absolutely
move. So we talked about already about personalised. Why have we not seen, please correct me if I'm wrong, so much disruption from a technology point of view in the commercial life insurance market, where the average premium is around £7,000 or more, and where the research that we've done in the last 3, 4, 5 years and various investments later has shown that people really value the fact that they built this business, which is effectively their baby, and ultimately, you know, if something goes wrong, they lose everything, the livelihood is not only themselves, but also the people that they employ. So they value the fact that they can speak to somebody who can advise them about their business and the insurance policy they take out. That, to me, is a higher margin business and is ripe for disruption. So why is everyone here so focused on personal lines?
I
used to do private equity. The issue there is you're looking historically. So if you were back in the early 2000s, you'd say Yahoo is taking it over, it's all done. Why are AltaVista launching another search engine? Pointless. Google? Ooh. And what you've got now? Yeah, okay, non-existent Yahoo. So I think the reality of the problem is really big, and thinking that it's going to stay status quo with the aggregators, who are, in my view, are actually exacerbating the issue, not solving it in any shape or form. And it doesn't seem to be going my only one. Every underwriter and every broker is happy with that. I agree with you. On commercial lines, there's a massive opportunity. The reality is, most people who are going to be addressing and wanting to take the risk and create something new are probably not as au fait with commercial lines. And also, if you look at commercial lines, there are quite a few, there's some clear segments where there's real opportunity to disrupt, but the reality is you're dealing a lot more with the incumbent, and you will need to do a lot more of working with, and working with the industry, as you would probably be dealing with on a regular basis, and yourself too, is basically, had a great meeting, awesome, let's meet up again very soon in 2 months' time. And that's basically death of any startup. So I think that dynamic makes it a lot tougher.
I think probably to a certain extent, just to jump in, I think to a certain extent there's a more significant inertia in commercial lines. And there's probably more transformation, there's more intergenerational shift happening. More disruptive forces in society today, sharing economy and so on and so forth, right, 2008, and that's causing changes in behaviour, I think, in consumer patterns, which is not necessarily manifesting itself fully yet into the commercial space. So it's just, I guess, my sense is it's a bit of a lower hanging fruit, or certainly transformation and creating opportunity. Notwithstanding the fact that absolutely you're right that price sensitivity in the consumer space is obviously very high, stickiness in some industries is very high, stickiness in other industries is very low. But yeah, absolutely, ticket size of premium is certainly higher in the commercial space.
Can I just add a little bit on that? We looked at a commercial product. We looked at leading with a cyber product for the SME marketplace, whereby we could then bolt on the likes of professional indemnity and employer's liability and the like, possibly a little bit of fleet motor. But we were struggling to get any capacity across what we wanted to offer, and ultimately what we wanted to do was a direct-to-consumer proposition. So I think we're coming, but it's not coming for us.
I've got to move on because we've got 15 minutes, 10 minutes left. Four questions in the audience, and at the end of this, in 10 minutes, I'm going to ask you to take venture an opinion by show of hands as to who's going to be successful and who's going to be around, right, on this current venture. Well, you can, of course you can. Okay, question here, please.
Thanks, guys. My question is around the consumer behavior change that is required for your products. Do you think it's a big change that is needed? And if so, how are you going to create that change?
Quick answer.
Yeah, for us, actually, the consumers get it more than the industry gets. You say, hey, you want to have one that wins. That's blinding the audience. But if you say that to someone actually in the industry, no, it's not that easy, and it's they just don't want to get it.
Right. Yeah, totally. Samir, traction.
Sure. Sorry?
Traction. This is the traction question, right? How do you get traction?
Traction, as in user acquisition.
How do you get traction?
Ultimately, we're working with brokers.
Okay,
interesting. Exactly. This is ultimately an answer, and my background is in marketing, growth hacking, and ultimately it's getting the service level out there to the people, the early adopters, etc. I mean, we're not trying to literally get every 70-year-old person to use our fully digital service, but mm-hmm. we'll get them by brokers. But ultimately, this connected life, this digital lifestyle is happening. We're not forcing it, we're going with it. So it's, for me, it's the race for data, it's the race for
traffic. What gives you that conviction? What if you're wrong?
Whether or not my company is successful is a completely different question, but there is no wrong or right to this, it's happening. I mean, this thing here just knows my heart rate right now, knows how far I'm walking, knows. Ultimately, Google and Apple are fighting for the connected home, the smart home, your car will be on the internet, your life will be on the internet, your body will be on the internet. That's going to be connected, it's going to be used. And we all want better services, and insurance is a big industry.
For those of you familiar with Jeffrey Moore's book, Crossing the Chasm, there's a very clear technology adoption life cycle, and it's who's going to cross that chasm. And there will be some of us that think we've crossed it and then blow up, and there will be some of us that don't realise we've crossed it, that have crossed it, and then they're like, oh, we've got very good problems. So yeah, it's just a case of who that will be. I can't say that will be me, I'm already going on this panel, but
yeah, sorry to trot out the off cliche, but the most dangerous thing to try to do is to cross a chasm in 2 weeks, right? Some will make it, yeah, you're right. Yeah.
To make it easy, we've just made it simple for the consumer. It's better, cheaper, and it can be up to 80% money back every year. It's kind of you don't have to change your behavior, you're just changing your provider, which is actually
more trusted. What's the acquisition strategy? I mean, how do you seed your base? I mean, of course you have this idea that you've got a great service and suddenly people are going to talk to you and, just money's just, you open the front door and the money's pouring in. Customers banging on the door.
Yeah,
how does that work? Right. Is it happening for you right now?
Yeah.
Great. Super. Okay, no need for the question. Here in the middle.
Yeah. I'm Ronald Willis. I'm independent software engineer and business consultant. I think it's a good topic. Mm-hmm. A great presentation, by the way.
Thank you.
It's a question, open question for the panel. What kind of growth do you see year on year for the next 5 years? And where do you get these skills from?
See for what?
For example, the seas or
business model. Not sure. Do any of you? Are any of you in a position to answer that?
Yeah, I mean, I'll answer it on the basis of an existing client we're talking to, a leading bank, 200 million customers worldwide, 2% conversion rate on that over a 10-year period. That's quite a substantial number of customers. So, although in terms of our charging model, we don't work on a commission basis, we give all the commission to the brand, and we charge them a service fee for the service level that we afford them. On each customer. So that's how we get traction.
Okay.
No one wakes up this morning and has to go and buy a BMW. But if you get sued, it's literally court ordered. And people are forced to use your product, which is kind of cool. So that happens 41,000 times a day in America. And law is a $437 billion a year industry that's just massively growing. So we have many different kind of flavors of ice cream to allow us to interact with consumers, law firms, general counsel, claims managers, et cetera, in many different ways. And and every month we have a new spin-off of things we can do with our data. Like, for example, on Sunday, you have to be in Silicon Valley and talk to 2,000 people because we found that our system can predict stock market performance for certain companies. I can't tell you where the stock will be, but I can tell you where it will be relative to another stock in the same industry. So there's huge amounts of potential for that.
Thank you. So it's a question on commercial lines. We've heard only one question so far on that. A lot on consumer, and I understand the reason for consumer focus right now. From my own experience in offshore energy infrastructure, which is actually critical infrastructure to the country, is there an argument for InsurTech to be applied in terms of the relationship between insurers and lenders for policy, or indeed for claimants, in terms of accelerating that process and therefore making a smoother process that enables bankability sooner? Is there a role, given that this is critical infrastructure being developed but not bankable soon enough, for the state to intervene with R&D for insurance, as well as R&D for technology?
So the government does not seem to like to provide capital for balance sheet risk. And so yes, for the technology aspects, you can find it. You can see that EIS, SEIS, Singapore had to deal with that pain, not be able to kind of be qualified for, but ultimately if you'll be able to do it for the kind of using technology and informing the underwriting, but not on the balance sheet risk, which is ultimately what you're really needing. So,
well, I think it's both actually. So I think the research I've done and the conversations I've had with insurers are that they don't have the time in the day, literally, to focus on the emerging technologies that are coming through. It's not just about putting the money up. It's about actually developing the policies themselves.
It's tough when you're working from 11 to 4.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, my point being is that R&D is not limited to actual physical tech. It could be applied to insure tech and insurance policies and the way that they are processed by the claim stage. So, that's what I'm getting at. And of course, upfront cash as well to back up that any claims was available.
I mean, I think the reality is there's a real opportunity in commercial. Absolutely enormous. There's so much data that is more available in commercial businesses that you could be using. And that's where ULOM's digital agencies kind of setting up and actually growing quite strongly. Because in trade insurance, there's a big opportunity there where fundamentally every organization has got kind of IT system to do the finances. Mm-hmm. Which is like, if you plug into that, you figure out most of all you need for your insurance. And in the same way, there's a lot of opportunity in the data. Actually, interestingly, schemas might be one you might want to look at, which actually empower and not kind of businesses, kind of even satellites,
yep.
Looking at purely data-driven business in getting there.
Yeah, thank you. I researched one last year. Yeah.
We have a claims product as well, but when the claims come in, that just looks very simply at what type of claim is it and where is it. So, for example, auto negligence in Cook County, Illinois, very plaintiff-friendly court. You want to pay that as fast as you can. You don't want that going in the court system. Mm. Same claim in Delaware, you might want to take your time in paying it. And then when you get the letter of representation from the attorney, based on whether this guy is just taking in a ton of claims, never takes them to trial, and frankly, is not very good, You take your time paying those claims and maybe put in a lower offer, whereas if there's a chap that is regularly taking things to trial and when he wins it hurts, that's the one you want to pay off quickly before he even gets the tickets.
Okay, any more questions from the audience? No, we're good. I'm not sure whether I feel briefly enough to be able to put you to trial by audience. I guess let's at least thank the panel for presenting. And thank you very much for generously giving up your time as well to participate. Let's hit the bar, I guess. If not here, then somewhere close by.
Question.
Sorry,
just one last question. You said what your business does. I'm not, this is a pit, I don't know.
Clark, awesome. So my venture is it's an MGA, but it's a pan-European proposition around personal lines, and we're a general insurer, and what we do is we look at risk, and we model risk inside personal behaviour using big data, and sorry about this machine learning in order to my background is behavioural risk for about 20 years in investment banking. And so what I do is we take a lot of publicly available and privately sourced data, which is currently in use by many insurance companies, except we just use a much, much, much larger data set. And what we do is we model behaviour and we model propensity towards and attitudes towards risk. And then we write policies for individuals. So it's a very specific play, but in terms of USP, it doesn't really. I mean, of course, yes, we do customer centricity and all that sort of stuff. But if you want to know more, I can tell you a little bit about it. Thanks very much, and I'll pay you that £5. I promised you. Thank you, Tanner. All right, fair enough. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.